Thank you all for coming. Thank you for your patience. We're a bit late, but some things, unfortunately, are not entirely in our control sometimes. Nevertheless, we'll start now as planned. Michael will now give first half an hour to maybe a bit more a lecture on some findings regarding the importance of the 1870s manuscripts, that is the manuscripts after volume one had already been published in 1867. Marx continued his work on volume two and three, and these manuscripts, as of recently fully available in German at least, in their original form, have been the object of intense research, and that research has had some significant repercussions and consequences for our understanding of Marx's project as a whole, including volume number one, and of course also the later volumes number two and three, which of course, as we know, were not published by Marx himself, but later, after Marx's death, compiled and edited by Friedrich Engels. So Michael will give a talk on that subject for, as we said, approximately half an hour. Then we can have a Q&A session. After that, we will have a short break, 5 to 10 minutes. The smokers among you always insist on such breaks. And then afterwards, we will continue more or less seamlessly with the conversation, which will then go more into the direction of the of his current research project or writing project, which is his big intellectual biography of Marx, originally planned for three volumes, as we have heard the day before yesterday. Now more likely to be four volumes. Volume number one has been published by the end of last year in German. The English translation is now will be published in June by Monthly Review Press. So we will be discussing a bit about the predicaments of that work and the difficulties and also the challenges he's facing, and also to what extent work on this biography has also changed to some extent Michael's own understanding of Marx's work. And we will then try in the end to circle back to this introduction. This is the Croatian translation, which the Center for Labor Studies published, which is available for free. You can pick up a copy if you don't have one here on the table, after all of this is over. And we will try to circle back a bit to the introduction itself, and maybe from the perspective of to what extent your recent work may or may not have maybe changed certain viewpoints on subject matters dealt with in the introduction. But more on that later. So this is a broad overview of what is planned, and we'll start now with the lecture itself. So, Michael, please.
Yeah, thank you for the introduction. In one point, I have to correct you. You said that all the manuscripts of Marx written in the 1870s are already published. This is not fully correct. A lot of manuscripts are published, but there are also the notebooks, the excerpts. They are not fully published, but they also, my argumentation rests also on these not published works. And where is this material published and will be published? It is the Marx-Engels Gesamtausgabe, MEGA, already the second attempt, which appears since the year 1875. And I think this is the real source. When you want to do real scientific work on Marx, then you have to use this MEGA. If you want to have more information, you can ask me afterwards. Now, I want in some respect to continue the lecture from Monday. In some respect continue. On Monday evening, I stressed the importance and the actuality of Marx's Capital for an analysis of contemporary capitalism. Today, I want to stress the unfinished and provisionary character of Marx's Capital. This is not a contradiction. I still think Marx's Capital is absolutely necessary to understand anything of contemporary capitalism. But for a deeper analysis, we also have to take into account the limits of capital. So I want to show in how far capital is unfinished. But before this, just a few words, what means unfinished? That Marx himself didn't manage to publish Capital, we all know. He published by himself Volume 1, and after his death, his friend and comrade Friedrich Engels published From the Heritage of Marx, Volume 2 and 3. So Marx didn't manage to finish Capital, to make it ready for print, but this is not meant when I speak of unfinished Capital. There is a widespread meaning of the unfinished capital when people say, okay, the capitalist system is still developing, so the analysis of the capitalist system is always unfinished. This is correct for the whole analysis, but as I stressed on Monday evening, Marx in Capital tries to analyze the basic structures, the core of capital, or what he called the inner organization of the capitalist mode of production in its ideal average. And this analysis of the ideal average is principally finite. This is not an infinite work, it is finite, but Marx didn't finish it. So what I want to stress is that the theoretical analysis, the connection of the basic categories which Marx wanted to present in Capital is not finished. Now, I can even stress this thesis. Not only Capital is not, the book Capital is not finished, it doesn't include all the results of Marx. This becomes clear just when we think of the years in which he wrote the respective manuscripts. Stiepe already mentioned Volume 1. The first edition was published in the year 1867. A second German edition appeared in the year 1872-73, and a French translation in which Marx inserted a number of changes appeared between 1872 and 75. The manuscripts on which Volume 1 rests, we can divide them in two groups. One group of these manuscripts were written between 1868 and 70, and the second group was written between 1876 and 81. Most recent manuscripts, we can say, when we think that Marx died in the year 83 and he could work in a scientific way until the year and the end of the year 81. In the year 82 and 83, until his death, not very much happened. And now let's come to Volume 3, this very important volume for the whole structure of Capital. The manuscript which Engels used to publish Volume 3 was written in the year 1864-65. It is the oldest manuscript when we regard the sequence of Volume 1, 2, and 3. Marx finished the work on this manuscript in December 65, But there were still 16 years of research about crisis, about the production process, about reproduction, and about the profit rate, which were not included in volume 3. This research process is documented in several longer manuscripts. They are already published in Mega, in the second section of Mega, but also valuable material is included in the notebooks of Marx, in the books where he had his excerpts, and in his letters. And on this material, manuscripts from the 70s, notebooks and letters, rests what I now try to present. And it should become clear that this research process gives us not only some additions or some more precise formulations, it really touches the basic structure, especially of volume 3, and the basic content of a number of important categories of volume 3. During the 1870s, Marx did a lot of studies. He studied books about natural sciences, about mathematics, about technology, and about history. A lot of the material about natural sciences and technology was designed for reworking his analysis of the production process and the question of communication, which plays in some respect a crucial role in volume 2, the production process in volume 1, the communication process in volume 2. Marx observed very thoroughly new technologies. But not only this was planned, also Marx was occupied with agricultural chemistry and with problems nowadays called ecological problems. The term didn't exist in Marx's times, but we can say in the 1870s, he was occupied a lot with ecological problems. And two or three years ago, Kohei Saito, a Japanese scholar who studied in Berlin, working with unpublished material of Marx, did his PhD, in which he showed very clearly the extent of this research of Marx and the consequences. Ecological questions in a new design of capital would have played a much more crucial role than they did. You all know probably that we can find important remarks also in the published Capital. For example, at the end of chapter 13, Marx says every progress in capitalist technology undermines the true real sources of wealth, nature, and human labor. Also in the manuscript for volume 3, you can find some remarks about the gap in the reproduction process of human mankind in capitalism and so on. But these are single remarks. What Kohei could make plausible that the consequences of the capitalist metabolism, or like Marx called it, Stoffwechsel zwischen Mensch und Natur, metabolism between human and nature under capitalist structure, has enormous consequences for nature, produces enormous, and systematically, not only accidentally, systematically a lot of destructions. I mention this only shortly because you have access to this very interesting study of Kohei Saito. His thesis is published in German under the title Kapital gegen Natur, and it is published in English under the title Marx Eco-Socialism at Monthly Review Press. So you can find a lot of material there. I want to stress on other changes Marx did in the 1870s, and I want to start with the credit system. As you probably know, in volume 3 of Capital, the biggest section has the title Interest-Bearing Capital. The first four chapters of this section really treat interest-bearing capital, but then chapter 25 to chapter 35, 11 chapters, treat with the credit system and the banking system. So you see, just by looking to the extent of the material, how important this was. But when you read these chapters, they give you a rather chaotic impression. And here plays a role that Frederick Engels published the material, and it is not really exactly the original material Marx left. The original material Engels tried to put in an order to make more readable for the readers. He had the best intentions, but I think especially in this material, chapter 25 to chapter 35, Engels' reordering of the material, reformulation of the material, he didn't present the original text, leads a little bit to more confusions than the original text of Marx. In the Capital reading groups in Berlin at Rosa Luxemburg Foundation, therefore we already use for this chapter Marx's original text. Now it is also available in English, so if you don't speak German, you can see this original text or read it also in English. Marx wanted to rework this material fundamentally, and he wanted also to introduce an important change. As Marx already in 1867 in the preface of the first volume wrote, he took his examples from England because England was the most advanced capitalist country. But for reworking the credit system for volume 3, Marx wanted to use his examples from the United States. In the 1870s, Marx was occupied very strongly with the economic development of the United States, and he realized that especially regarding the credit system, the development in the States was enormously quick, much quicker than in England, and that in producing modern credit structures, England, United States was even ahead compared with England. So the empirical material for the reworking of the credit system should be the United States. This is one important aspect. The other important aspect is that Marx in the 1870s also saw the growing role, the rising role of national banks. We must have in mind that the double structure of the banking system, which is very familiar to us from the 20th century, that we have private banks on the one hand, and a state-run but more or less independent from the government, being national bank, a central bank, was only emerging in Marx times. This was not the structure in Marx times. You had a kind of national bank, but this was like, for example, the Bank of England, a private bank in Marx times, but very regulated by law. This was just the transitional period to the modern banking system of 20th century. And Marx, in his analysis in the 1870s, he paid very much attention of the role of the growing role of the national banks and the role of the public credit. So these issues he wanted to include in the reworking of the credit system. But on the other hand, when you have in mind the original plan for the credit system, this will cause a big problem. Marx wanted to analyze in Capital the capitalist mode of production. The capitalist state should be analyzed only after the analysis of this capitalist mode of production in a single book separated from Capital. But when now, with the national bank and with the public credit, state affairs play such an important role for the credit system, and the credit system plays such a crucial role for the capitalist production, and as we can learn from volume 2, also for the capitalist reproduction, then we have the question, is this separation of a pure analysis of the capitalist mode of production with an abstraction from the state, is this still possible? Or do we have to include the state much more basically into the analysis of the capitalist mode of production? I didn't find any remark of Marx to this issue, but when we follow the line of his analysis, where we find enough traces to include national banks, public credit, then it is clear that this question, in how far the state, the capitalist state, has to be included in the analysis of the capitalist mode of production, would be the next question to which Marx is confronted, and probably it would also come to a big change in the way of analyzing. So I come to the next point, which appears rather important. At the end of the 1860s, Marx learned the Russian language in order that he can read Russian economic literature. And when he died, Engels, and Engels looked to the books in Marx's desk room, he found several meters of Russian economic literature. So Marx was very, he followed this, and especially to one book written by Kovalevsky, a Russian guy who also visited London several times. Marx and Engels knew him personally, and he wrote a book about the common property in Russia, in Russian history. There is already a very extensive notebook where Marx not only makes excerpts but also commentary about common property in Russia. And I think together with his ethnological notebooks show they show not only the wide scope of Marx's scientific interest, it also gives some hints that Marx became in the 1870s a very clear understanding that the course of history is not a linear course of one line of development, but a course of many lines of development and also of many roads to capitalism. So his Russian studies were intended not only for the section on the ground rent, where he intended to use the Russian development of the ground rent and perhaps also doing a comparison between the US-American development of ground rent and the Russian development of ground rent. I think it belonged also to studies of the origins of capitalism. We have also very extensive notebooks from Schlosser's Weltgeschichte, World History. Schlosser was a rather progressive German author who wrote a 12-volume World History, and in the 1870s, Marx did extensive notes from this book and from the themes he touched. We can assume that Marx wanted to rework his section on original accumulation. What is the last, in the German edition, the last or the pre-last chapter of volume one, where he gave the example how original accumulation happened in England. In the 70s, he learned this is just one trace. This is not even the typical trace. Maybe there is not a typical trace. And we know also from a letter Marx wrote in December 1881 to Danielson that he wanted not only to rework the manuscripts for volume 2 and 3, but also to rework the already published volume 1. And I assume that to this reworking of volume 1, also the chapter on original accumulation would belong. And I think the studies about Russia, the excerpts on Schlosser's World History would contribute to such a reworking. Now, the last two points I want to mention, crisis theory and the legendary law of the falling profit rate, both encapsulated in volume 3. In volume 3, we can find the most extensive treatment of crisis theory, especially in chapter 15. And this crisis theory, we can say, is mainly a production-oriented crisis theory. Marx deals with it before he comes to interest-bearing capital and the credit system. In parts, this crisis theory rests on this law of the profit rate, not totally, some parts rests on this, but many Marxists received or perceived this crisis theory as a kind of derivation from this law of the falling profit rate. All this was written before the year 66. In December 65, Marx finished with the manuscript of volume 3. In the course of the year 66, we had a new crisis of England, Marx was very much impressed by this crisis because it had a new character. It had a purely financial character, and only from this financial crisis it had a kind of repercussion to the production system. So it was very much, it had a big difference to the kind of crisis Marx saw before. And Marx was so impressed by this crisis that he put some small remarks in volume one, in the second part of volume one, which was not sent to the publisher. You can see these remarks in chapter 23. They come out of the blue. They have not really a connection with the issues of chapter 23. Marx just wanted to have some remarks about this financial character of the crisis. When the manuscript of volume one was sent to the publisher, Marx received in 67 the proof sheets to correct. And when this was done, the crisis was over, but Marx was so interested that he filled two notebooks with an analysis of this crisis. He had collected newspapers, he put newspaper articles, statistics, and so on in these two notebooks about the crisis of 66. And because he saw the importance of the monetary character, he also did, he filled another notebook with analysis of the monetary market. So his occupation with crisis became, after he finished volume three, much more monetary directed than the analysis of crisis was before. Something similar happened in the 1870s. In the second half of the 1870s, a crisis in Europe started, which also had a new character. Until then, we had crisis with a rather quick downwards movement, bankruptcies, rise of unemployment, but then also a rather quick recovery of the economy. This crisis of the second half of the 1870s was the first long-lasting stagnation crisis. The downwards movement was not quick, and a recovery movement was not visible. Indeed, this crisis lasted until the 1890s. It lasted after Marx's death. Marx analyzed this crisis in his notebooks and also in several letters, and there he stressed especially the role of the national banks, the role of the credit system, and the international relations, that the crisis in one country was not so big like in another country, and so the one country helped, not intentionally as a kind of automatic process, the other country. So, and he saw the importance of these developments. Nikolai Danielsen, the Russian translator of volume one, asked him, when will volume two and three appear? Because he wanted to continue the translation. And Marx told him in a letter of the year 1878, I cannot finish Capital until this crisis will reach at least its top, because I have to consume it theoretically. So Marx was very conscious that his crisis theory, as we know it from the manuscript of volume three, written in the years 64, 65 is theoretically not finished. He needs the analysis of this stagnation crisis to make a theoretical step forward. But he couldn't do this. He died before. But again, a big theoretical problem became visible. Marx realized here not only the role of the national credit, he realized the role of the international capitalist system, of the differences in the development between several countries. He realized that he cannot talk about a crisis in one country when he is not taking into account the capitalist world market. But again, his original plan was to discuss the world market only after having analyzed state and capitalist mode of production in its ideal average. And again, we see here the question, is this possible? Is there not a big change in the structure of capital necessary so that Marx has to include the world market much more basically than he thought in the 1860s. And now, to extend not the time too much, I just come to my last point, this famous law of the tendency of the profit rate to fall. In 20th century, this law was disputed a lot. Just to remind you what the law says there is a tendency that by the rising organic composition of capital, rising organic composition means that the constant capital, which is advanced for machinery, raw material, is growing much more fast than the variable capital, meaning the capital which is advanced for labor force, that this rise in the organic composition will, as a tendency, result in a falling rate of profit. The capitalists need more and more machines, but profit in the last instance comes only from human labor. Human labor plays a smaller role compared with machines, and insofar surplus value profit, there should be a point where the production of surplus value and profit will result in a falling rate of profit. This law was disputed very much in 20th century. I also contributed to this dispute, and I don't think that one really can give reason, can give arguments that there is a necessary such tendency. There is, of course, again and again, a fall in the profit rate, but what we see is an up and down in the profit rate, that there is really a necessary tendency. I think Marx cannot give convincing reasons, and all the help constructions in the discussion, I think, are not really convincing. But this is not the point here. My point here is that from the manuscripts, I conclude that also Marx himself in the 1870s had decisive doubts in this law. He developed this law in the early 1860s. The last research regarding this law is in the manuscript of volume 3, written in 64-65. The last time he mentions this law is in the year 68 in a letter to Engels, where he just referred to him the chapters what he wants to present in volume 3, and there he mentions also this law. But in all his discussions about crisis, and also in his manuscripts in the 1870s, this law never was mentioned. So when this law is really the most important law, as Marx wrote in the manuscript of volume 3, why it was not mentioned after the year 68? Second, from the end of the 60s and from the 70s, we have several manuscripts now published in Mega, where Marx did a lot of mathematical calculation about the connection between organic composition, the rate of surplus value, and the rate of profit. And all these calculations show that that there is not a necessary tendency with the rate of profit. Even with a strong rise of the organic composition, the rate of profit also can rise or it can fall. Everything is possible, but no necessary tendency. And in an extensive manuscript written in the year 1875, Marx states that in this manuscript he wants to describe the laws of the profit rate. The laws of the profit rate, but a law of the tendency of the profit rate to fall is not anymore mentioned. So in the year 1875, obviously, Marx counted this former law not anymore among the laws of the profit rate. And then we have also an indication since more than 100 years, but we couldn't really use this indication. Also, when I saw it the first time, I didn't believe what it was written there. In Marx's hand copy of the second volume, or of the second edition of volume 1 of Capital, in the section on accumulation, there is a note. Engels inserted this note, says this note was found in the personal copy of Marx. And what did Marx state there? He made the statement, when we have accumulation of a capital with a qualitative change in the composition of capital, meaning with a rising organic composition, then the profit rate is higher than with accumulation with a constant organic composition. This is exactly the opposite of the law of the falling profit rate. Marx makes the statement, with a rising organic composition, mostly the profit rate also will rise and not will fall. And this footnote is included in the third volume of Capital since Frederick Engels published it. So we all can read this footnote since more than 100 years. But we didn't understand this. When I wrote this footnote, I also thought, it's strange, but it is an isolated footnote. I don't know, perhaps Engels did a mistake when he inserted this. No, he didn't know. We have now also published the original manuscript. It is Marx's footnote.
Can you explain how you resolve this seeming contradiction between...
Yeah, I'm just on the way. When I said, when I first read it, my resolution was probably it's a mistake. Either it's a mistake by Engels, or it is a mistake by Marx. He drank a glass of wine too much and confused something, because the note was so isolated. But now we have these calculating manuscripts of the 70s, where the calculations of Marx exactly show what he wrote. even with an organic, with a rise in the organic composition, we have not necessarily a tendency of a falling profit rate. We have also a rising profit rate. And in so far, my solution now is that Marx in the 70s overcame his former law of the profit rate. He abolished this law, and if he would manage to publish volume 3 of Capital in the 70s, or if he would have lived enough in the 80s, I'm rather sure that we wouldn't find a law of the tendency of the profit rate to fall in this volume 3. Insofar, now I'm come really to the end, Engels really did his best when publishing volume 3 rests, and the publication rests on the manuscript of 64-65. But this manuscript, 64-65, not at all represents really Marx's research level he had reached at the end of the 1870s. And when we discuss about Marx, we should take into account at least the hints of this research level he reached in the 1870s. Thank you very much for your attention.
So the idea now is to have Q&As. We don't have that much time, but we'll squeeze a couple in. I'll monopolize my and abuse my monopoly as a moderator and simply continue, because I'm still a bit puzzled with that last point. Not in the sense of that I am one of those people who thinks it is of vital importance for Marxism to maintain the so-called law of the falling rate of tendency of the falling rate of profit, which many Marxists have not forgiven you for questioning it. I'm not one of those. But still, conceptually, there is a problem with stating that, in the, for me at least, as I understand it, with the change in the organic composition of capital, how can... Is it a question of differentiating the profit rate from the rate of surplus value? Is that the crux of the argument, or so my question is not now whether you have found the material that proves that Marx in fact changed his opinion because he saw that in under certain circumstances a change in the organic composition of capital can lead to a increasing rate of profit, but how conceptually, how is it, how to explain conceptually this very possibility? And why did Marx not see it before?
To come to this point, rising organic composition, when we consider this isolated, ceteris paribus, then rising organic composition leads to a falling profit rate. A rising rate of surplus value, when we look isolated on this, ceteris paribus, it leads to a rising profit rate. So, organic composition, rising organic composition, rising surplus rate have contradictory effects on the profit rate. And the question is simply which tendency in the long run is stronger. In the 60s, Marx was convinced that the effect of rising organic composition is stronger. He just searched for the convincing argument, but he was convinced it must be this. At the end of the 60s and in the 70s, he did really extensive calculations. He calculated first with numbers, he tried to generalize this a little bit, and by the many cases he did, today we would say he did case studies. And by these many case studies, it became clear that there is not one prevailing case. One case we can say this is the dominant case. It became clear everything is possible. But when everything is possible, then we cannot speak of a tendency. And in so far, there is not a note of Marx that he wrote, oh, now I saw I was wrong with this law. No. It is more indirect in the year 75 when he wrote this big manuscript where he claimed, I want to state the laws of the profit rate. And this law of the falling profit rate was not even mentioned as a law. This, I think, indicates that Marx overcame this. And I think he overcame it just by the clarity of the numbers that there is not one dominating case.
So I think we can now go to the audience.
I wanted to ask this question on Monday, but we didn't have enough time, so I didn't. You said on Monday that it's very easy to get rid of the inequality in today's world. You said it just to do some sort of redistribution. I quote. You said something like it's easy to solve this inequality by redistribution. So my question is, I don't believe that it's really easy to do it. And this is nothing personal. I would love if that could happen and we get rid of the inequality. But for instance, if your solution is progressive taxes, then we all know that kind of leads to a political instability. So my question is, how would you do it? And how would the people welcome it in this today's capitalist world?
Sorry, this was a misunderstanding. I put this probably in the wrong way. I don't say it is easy to overcome inequality. And I don't have any recipe like progressive taxes. I wanted to make another statement, to say even if we imagine we can overcome inequality or even we reduce inequality, the capitalist system has still enough problems, gives us enough reason that we should think how to overcome this system. But I didn't want to diminish the problem of overcoming inequality. It was only to say, even just imaginary, this problem could be solved or tackled. It is not enough to make peace with capitalism.
The capitalistic way of production exists today. So does Marx's theory of classes exist today?
Of course. I could give you a very simple answer and say, of course. But I don't want to do it so simple. When we speak about class issue, like many others, I stressed on Monday, Marx analyzed this ideal average, the core, the basic structures. But capitalism has a changing historical shape, and we must do both. We must use Marx's analysis of the basic structure, and we must, in every decade, in every society, we must add the analysis of this historical shape. And so maybe the working class today looks different like the working class 50 years ago, 100 years ago. And then I want to stress something else, what seems to me very important for class theory. And this I stressed also in this introduction where the translation you can get here for free. There are two notions of class. in Marx implicitly. He's not very clear to distinguishing this, but I think implicitly you can find two different notions. A structural notion which says capitalism rests on exploitation, the workers are exploited, they sell their labor power, they are forced to sell their labor power because they have no other chance to survive in this system. So you have a working class, no matter if the single workers have a consciousness that they belong to the working class. This is a structural category. Then you have class as a historical category, as a sociological category, a group of persons who has the conscious, who defines themselves as we are a class in a contradiction to another class. And what is important is not to confuse the structural notion of class with the historical notion of class. In Marxist tradition, I think there is a big misleading road to assume that the structural class position leads automatically to a historical class consciousness, and then the historical class consciousness leads more or less automatically to a revolutionary class consciousness. This, I think, these two automatisms doesn't exist at all. And insofar, in the analysis, we always have to think about structural analysis. Here the things are very clear, classes exist, and then we have to look to the historical classes, to the consciousness about class, and this depends on the situation. There is not always a class consciousness or a development, a road to class consciousness. But for both analyses, we need Marx's work.
So my question is about the falling rate of profit again. What is your position on empirical attempts to measure and document the falling rate of profit, the tendency of the profit rate to fall? So I'm thinking of works like those written by Michael Roberts and Anwar Kshaik and people like them, who, you know, produce graph after graph showing that in the 50s and 60s profit rates were high, then in the 70s and 80s they fell, and then they kind of recovered during the neoliberal period, and now they're falling down again. And so even if Marx gave up on his ideas from the 1860s, during his work in the 1870s, those ideas might still hold if we can empirically trace them.
We have to make an important distinction between a falling rate of profit, which can happen empirically, and the law of the tendency of the falling profit rate. This is not identical. The law says there are structural reasons in the process of capitalist development that in the long run, the profit rate must fall. This is something else than to say during 1960 and 1970, the profit rate was falling. I don't deny any empirical results. I don't deny the possibility that the profit rate can fall for a decade, for two decades, for three decades. I deny that we can derive from the very basic features of a capitalist system a law of a tendency of the profit rate to fall in the long run. And this tendency we also cannot prove empirically. Because empirically, first, it is not clear what is the long run. It is the same story like the sellers of shares, they always prevent, provide you some statistics. Buy these shares, the share prices go up. You just have to choose the starting point and the end point of your statistic so that you can find a rising tendency. When you choose different points, then perhaps you have a falling tendency. But I don't want to accuse Michael Roberts, a person I estimate very high, to do such tricks. I accuse him of something else. I accuse him of an uncritical use of statistics. The basic problem with statistics is we use Marx categories, but the statistics is done by state statistical bureaus, offices, which have bourgeois categories. They don't use the Marxian profit rate, they use other categories. So in order that a Marxist can make use of these statistics, a translation process is necessary. You must say, okay, the statistics is not really measure what I want to have measured, but we can take it as a certain indication. And this always has problems. For the long run, it gives us also a very fundamental problem. Each 25, 30 years, the basics of these statistics change. So when you have a timeline of 50, 60 years, it is not really a serious research, because the first 30 years rests on a different basis than the last 30 years. So to use statistics, and I don't say you cannot use it in any way, but the use of statistic is not just simple to construct diagrams. It needs a lot of critique of statistics, which is usually not done.
Okay, I think we'll end the first part here. Thank you, Michael, for the lecture. Thank you for your patience and participation. Only for those who are now who are not in on why something so seemingly technical like the organic rise or fall of the organic composition of capital can arouse so many passionate debates, I would again direct you to the introduction, where you will get explained why it was and still is important within Marxist debates, and also in a more, I would say, in a more systematic way, you can you'll be able to read Michael's logical refutation of the original formulations of the law as law. Okay. So much for now. Those of you who are interested in the continuation of this discussion in a more open format, in 5 minutes here again, please. Thank you.